Now that we're back in Point Builder, we can begin the creation of our new tags. So the important thing to pay attention to when creating tags for OPC is the instrument tag field under the Classic tab. And if you recall, this matches the item ID that we see in the OPC client tool. Why don't we choose a few points from the OPC client tool to create tags for? We'll start with random int 1. So for random int 1, we notice that the item ID is random.int1. Going back to the SMT, we can create a tag for random int 1. So for the name, we'll just put random int 1. And because this is an OPC tag, we want to make sure that the point source matches what's in the interface, which is OPC. And since this is an integer tag, we'll go ahead and change the point type to int. In the archive tab is where you would change the compression and exception settings. In this case, we'll just leave them as default. Under the classic tab, what we want to pay attention to is the instrument tag, which we will fill in as the item ID from the OPC client. The next thing we want to change are locations 1 and 4. So for location 1, this matches the item ID that was in the interface, which if you remember, we left as 1. And for location 4, what should we pay attention to for that one, Camille?
So location 4 is used for this interface to designate which scan class to use. And so if you recall, back on the OPC node, in the ICU, we have several scan classes listed. So let's go back to that node. And looking at the ICU under the general tab, you'll see the scan frequencies and their corresponding scan class number. And these scan frequencies can be edited if you do a right click and then edit scan class. So let's change this one to say 3 seconds. Now for the OPC interface, scan class 1 is reserved for vice tags. And so if we want to do a pull tag, we would need to choose a different scan class. So how about we choose a 2-second scan frequency and stick with scan class number 2, which means we would need to pick a location 4 equals 2.
Okay, so we'll go ahead and fill in 2 for location 4 to specify that we want to use the second scan class. Now that our random int 1 tag is created, we can go ahead and create random int 2 and random int 4. An easy way to do this is just by refilling in the name field with the name of the new tag and making sure that the instrument tag is also changed to correspond with the correct tag. And then hitting the save button will create the new tag for us. Now that we've created our 3 OPC tags, let's check to see that we're getting data for them. If we go to current values, we can do a quick search by typing in OPC as the point source. There's our 3 tags. We'll select all of them. And you'll notice that the value shows point created. Since they were just created, it may take up to 2 minutes for the interface to pick up the new points. If we go back to the OPC interface node and check the message log, it will show once the new points have been picked up. So here we can see that the OPC has added 3 new points, which means it should be sending data for those points to the PI server. Back in SMT, we'll refresh, and we see that we are getting data for these 3 OPC points. Clicking the Start Updating button will make them update continuously. Now that we have working OPC tags, the next thing that we would like to do is to enable buffering. To enable buffering, we go to Tools and Buffering. But before we do that, we need to make sure that the interface is stopped. Once we've stopped the interface, we go back to the buffering settings under Tools and Buffering, and we will choose to enable buffering with the PI buffer subsystem. In the buffered servers, we'll choose our PI server as the server to buffer the data to. We want to make sure that under the buffered server names, we choose name as the option, since our host is specified by its name and not by the IP address or the path. We'll go ahead and start the buffer subsystem. Once we've started the PI buffer subsystem, we'll go back to the ICU page And when we click on the service tab of the interface, IC will prompt us to add the dependency for PipeFSS, and we'll click yes. When we restart the interface, all of the data now will pass through the buffer before going to the PI server. A way that we can check that the data is passing through the buffer correctly is by using a utility called PyBuffSS. This is located in the PyHome/bin directory. Once we get to the bin directory, we can type in PyBuffSS -?, which will give us a list of the parameters that we can use with this utility. We're interested in seeing what's in the queue, so we'll use -qs. We'll type in PyBuffSS -qs, which will bring up the queue statistics of the buffer. You'll notice that there are two columns of numbers. The left-hand column shows the totals, whereas the right-hand column shows the number of changes since the last refresh. The queue statistics refreshes every 5 seconds. Right now we can see that the total event writes and the total event reads match, and that if we look at the current queue events, it's zero. This means that data is being written to the buffer and being read from the buffer, but there are no queued events, which means the data is passing straight through the buffer to the PI server. Now, if we want to see what happens when the PyBuffSS loses connection with the PI server, what we can use is PyBuffSS and a different parameter. So if we go back to the question mark, we see that there's a -bc. We will use the -bc stop to simulate a disconnect from the PI server, and then take another look at the queue statistics. Back in the queue statistics, we notice that in current queue events, it is no longer 0, and there's a 3, which means that there are events building up in the queue. This is to be expected since we've lost connection with the PI server, and data is now being buffered. If we go back to PyBuffSS -bc and type in start instead of stop, we will regain the connection to the PI server. Going back to the queue statistics, we can see that it flushes almost immediately, and there are no longer any queued events. So now that buffering has been enabled and set up, and we have our three OPC tags, the next step in our installation process is to go to the client machine so we can install client applications which can view the data that we're getting from the OPC server. And this will be demonstrated by Camille in the following section.